Okay, hi guys, I hope you're doing well. So welcome to this AAA revision marathon session. This is Luqman Rafiq. Let me just introduce myself a bit. So I've been in teaching profession for more than 14 years now, teaching different courses. The different courses that I've been teaching includes the auditing, includes finance and management, the performance management, and the reporting courses. So I've been doing it for the ACCA and for the other qualifications also. Now, what I'm actually going to do with you people in today's session is that I would actually be starting with one of the papers on the ECCA platform, which is about the mock examinations. So there are different type of mock examinations that we would actually be doing. So I repeat, there are different type of mock examinations that we would be doing, which are available on the ACCA CB practice platform. So I'm going to start off. And what I've actually done is that I've listed down one of the AAA pre-December 2022 mock examination that is available on the ACCA CB practice platform. I'm going to be using this specific mock examination and will be attempting the mock examination with you people. So the main objective and the main agenda for this is that I need to take you people through the questions and to actually discuss with you people that how exactly would you be answering the questions in the examination. So there's this mock examination now. You know that whenever you go through, you have to actually start off with these different type of things. Now, there is this question, this section A, where there is this question number one. The question is worth 50 marks. And when we are going to be doing this specific question, we would actually have to do what? We would have to actually apply the different concepts. You would have to apply the different scenarios. So let's just start doing it. Let's just start discussing this question. So basically, the first question that we have actually got is about Craigie income. And this is how the standard examination question of AAA is going to. So what I'm going to do now is that I'm going to start discussing that how would you attempt this AAA questions in the examination. Let's just see. You are being given this information on the right-hand side. Then there are different exhibits that are given in the question. So if I read through this specific thing, I would first of all open the requirement of the question. It says respond to the instructions in the email from the audit engagement partner. The split of marks allocation is shown in exhibit one partner's email. The second thing that it does is that it says that professional marks will be awarded for the demonstration of a skill in communication. So you would have to actually be getting the marks for the communication skills, for the analysis skills, for the evaluation skills, professional skepticism and judgment and commercial acumen. So all those areas of the skills are actually being examined and you'll be getting marks in all those areas. Now let's just have a quick discussion about all this. So you know that the 10 professional marks are actually there. Now it says it is 1st of July 2005. It is 1st of July 2005. And you are a manager in the audit department of Craigie & Co, a firm of chartered certified accountants. And you're responsible for the audit of TED company. So it's a TED company question that we have to do. Company has a financial year ended 30th June 2005. And you're about to start planning the audit. What are you about to do? You're about to start planning the audit. The following exhibits available on the left-hand side of the screen provide information relevant to the question. Partner's email. An email which you have received from Jack Hackett, the audit engagement partner. If I could just talk about the email that we have received from the audit engagement partner, what does it say? I would simply copy the whole email. I would copy the whole email. Why? Because ultimately, this email is going to act as my questions requirement. So I've copied the whole email. It says I require you to prepare briefing notes for my use in which you, number one, discuss the matters specific to the planning of an initial audit engagement. Number two, evaluate and prioritize the significant audit risks to be considered. Number three, explain the correspondence and so design the principal audit procedure in the audit of what the portfolio of short-term investments and in the earnings per share. So that is something that you have to do. So there are multiple requirements to this question, which we would have to actually discuss. So I just copied all the requirements here. The reason being that I know if I'm just going to copy all the requirements here, this is actually going to make things easy for me. I would already know what requirements do I need to answer. And just I could just go on looking at the different aspects of the question and could just keep on answering the requirements. So basically, it says that I have provided you with some information in the form of number of exhibits which should you use to help with the planning of the audit of TED company. So it's the audit of TED company for the financial year ended so and so. Now, what next is there? Based on the analysis I have on this industry, it is appropriate for overall materiality to be based on the profitability of the company, as this is a key focus for investors. So what he is suggesting is that you should focus on the profitability for the materiality determination. You should focus on profitability as the materiality determination. Now, it says using information so and so. Now, I would actually go about discussing all of this, because the first thing that I need to do here is that I need to discuss the matters specific to the planning of an initial audit engagement, which should be considered while developing the audit strategy. So again, what you need to do is that you need to talk about the factors, the areas that should be considered while doing this initial audit engagement. Now, let me just guide you a bit about this, that what are the things that we usually considered with respect to the initial audit engagement, so that you could have a bit of an idea and you could just write down the answer accordingly. You see, this is a question which is pertaining to TED company, but there are things which are standardized with respect to this requirement of the question. It's not something that it would change with respect to TED company, or it's not something that would change with respect to any other company. It's going to stay the same. So whenever you have got initial audit engagement, there are a few things that you have to consider, which is number one of them is the discussion with the outgoing auditors. The initial audit engagements are the ones where you are actually doing the audit for the first time for a company. So you have to discuss with the outgoing auditors. That's the number one thing that you actually have to do. Also, what you need to do is that you need to consider the previous year audit reports. So you got to consider the previous year audit reports also, that what is actually going on with respect to the previous year's audit report. Plus, what actually happens is that there has to be a professional clearance that needs to be obtained from the outgoing auditors. From the outgoing auditors, you got to be obtaining the professional clearance also. Furthermore, what happens is that the opening balances need to be considered. I will just list down further that what are the things that need to be considered with respect to all this. So with respect to the initial audit engagement, the factors which needs to be considered while doing the audit strategy is another one of them is understanding of the business is to be done. And what happens is that the ethical and quality control factors to be considered. Now, let's just try to discuss this. So what is it that we need to do? The first thing is that the discussion with the outgoing auditors. So what are the things that you discuss with the outgoing auditors? So with the outgoing auditors, what you do is that with respect to the outgoing auditors, you try to discuss any factors that they would like to highlight in relation to the audit concern, in relation to the audit conducted. Furthermore, the working papers, if they can share, the working papers, if they can share. The working papers, if they can share. If last year reports have been modified, then reasons for the modification. If no modification has ever taken place, then need to assess if the outgoing auditors were independent or not. So this is again part of the communication where a sort of no objection is obtained from the outgoing auditors. The audit of opening balances need to be conducted with respect to the correct balances being brought forward. So the opening balances, the consistency of the accounting policies. From the previous periods. So ISA 315, understanding of business environment, risk of material misstatements. So all of this is required to be done. The ethical and the quality control factors. With respect to the ethical and the quality control factors, what is it that you need to do? So with respect to the ethical and quality control factors, you need to see that the acceptance of the engagement meets the criteria laid down in the code of ethics. The quality control criteria is also met while undertaking the engagement. So you see, I have not read the question. I've just directly listed down something because you see, from the perspective of the exam, there are few things which are bookish for which you don't have to know the scenario. Obviously, when I'm going through the scenarios, there are possibly going to be few things that I would consider. But generally speaking, you don't have to consider the scenarios for the bookish type of a stuff, and you could just impart the whole knowledge that you have. Now, am I going to be writing down the answer this way? The answer is no. I'm going to be writing down the short paragraph. So every single pointer that I have written down here, I would actually be writing down the short paragraph. You get my point? Okay, good enough. Now let's move a bit forward and let's just discuss further. Now, next we are actually going to be discussing further. Just give me a minute, please. Okay. Now let's just try to see what are the other aspects of the question. So I'm now going to go on to this other aspect, which is the background information. Let's just see that what is the background information that is given. And in fact, the second requirement of the question is evaluate and prioritize the significant risk audit risk to be considered in planning the audit of TED company for the financial year ending 30th June 2005. So as and when I'm going to proceed with the question, I'll actually keep on writing down the things that would come my way. It says TED company designs and develops computer games and has grown rapidly in the last few years. Jack Hackett, the audit engagement partner, met with the company's finance director last week to discuss the company's background and business developments. So to me, they are developing the computer games and they have grown rapidly in the last few years. I don't know, but I'm just writing down game development is a high risk area. Because obviously the games, they get outdated and then ultimately your all development could go in waste. Then it says, TED company was formed 10 years ago by Dougal Doyle, a graduate in multimedia computing. The company designs, develops and publishes computer games, including many highly successful games which have won industry awards. In the last 2 years, company invested $100 million in creating games designed to appeal to a broad global audience, and sales are now made in over 60 countries. So there is basically a significant expenditure in development of the games has taken place. Plus, I'm writing down one more thing. Sales in multiple countries. So the FX transactions accounting could be a risk. I don't know, but I'm just writing down things. It says the software used in the computer game is developed in this country, but the manufacture of the physical products takes place overseas. The previous auditor is a small firm called Crilly & Co. Resigned in October, so-and-so. So the outgoing auditors were a small firm. The audit opinion on financial statement was unmodified. Now what next is there? If I could just go back to the question, I could say that with respect to this TED company, this is the background information that I've got. They design and develop the game. Now notes from the meeting. Now what are the notes from the meeting? So let's just try to go through these notes from the meeting. It says, meeting attendees, Jack Hackett, the audit engagement partner, Craigie & Go, Lee Brennan, the finance director. Computer games are largely sold through retail outlets, but approximately 25% of the revenue is generated through the sales made on company's website. In some countries, TED companies' products are distributed under licenses, which give the license holder the exclusive right to sell the products in that country. Okay, so that means basically you are hiring distributors in some countries. The cost of each license to the distributor depends on the estimated sales in the country to which it relates. And licenses last for an average of 5 years. You see, what happens is that, I'm just going to write down one more thing. The sales licenses are sold. The duration is for 5 years. Yeah, this is Vivek. You are perfectly right. There is the outgoing auditors were small, and the company had grown very rapidly. So there could be a possibility that their methodology, their work, their action plan, it would not have been as good as what is needed at this level. So there could have been multiple unattended mistakes and things like that. So yes, you are right in that. Duration is for 5 years. Income is deferred. There could be issues with accounting for revenue related to these. Let's move a bit more forward and let's discuss further. It says, as part of the 5-year strategic plan, TED company obtained a stock market listing in January 2005. So it's a listed company, listed during the current year only. Now, whenever you have the listing during the current year, so there is automatically a risk. The reason being that the management would like to show a better financial picture. And when they would like to show better financial picture, so they might actually do some fabrication, they might do some window dressing in the financial statements. The listing and related share issues raise a significant amount of finance, and many shares are held by institutional investors. Degel Doyle retains 20% of the shareholding, and a further 10% of the company shares are held by the family member. So around 30% of the shares are held by family members and the CEO. Again, they have a personal interest in this company. Then what happens is that, you see, I'm just listing down the pointers. I'm not writing down the answer to anything. We are just going to do the answers as we proceed, but right now I'm just listing down the pointers. It says that despite being listed, the company does not have an internal audit department and there is only one non-executive director on the board. These problems which TED management is hoping to resolve in the next few months are explained in the company's annual report as required by the applicable code of corporate governance. Now, what happens is that COCG compliance is weak. So therefore, weak internal controls. And when you have got weak internal controls, there is a risk of multiple misstatements that could possibly exist. It says recently, a small treasury management function was established to manage the company's foreign currency transactions, which include forward exchange currency contracts. Okay. The use of derivatives, which are the complex instrument handled by small treasury teams. This may mean that accounting may not be appropriate. It's a complex area. I repeat, it's a complex area. The accounting may not be appropriate. Now, what next is there? It says in February, cash of $8 million was invested in a portfolio of equity shares held in listed companies, which is to be held in the short term as speculative investment. Shares are recognized as financial asset at cost in the financial statement. Now, what happens is that inappropriate accounting for the equity investments. As listed company, TED is required to disclose its EPS. Dougal Dial like this to be based on adjusted earning figure, which does not include depreciation and so on. The CEO is influencing how the EPS figure is to be calculated. So when you've got the chief executive officer who is actually influencing how the EPS figure is going to be calculated, so that's actually a problematic situation. I bet that's actually a problematic situation. The reason being that this would actually mean what? This would actually mean that ultimately the calculations may be incorrect and this would lead to a problem. Yes, will lead to conflict of interest. And ultimately, what could actually be the issue with respect to financial statement is that maybe they would like to have their own influence in the financial statement preparation. And the financial statement may have got a lot of fabrication, a lot of window dressing. That is something that could happen. Yes. Now, with respect to this selected financial information, they've given us selected financial information. They've talked about the revenue growth, 46.3%. The gross profit has grown by 62.5%. Operating profit margin is this, finance charges is this, profit before tax is this. The EPS for the current year is given, comparative figure is not given. EPS calculation. There's a flaw with respect to EPS calculation. You're not doing some management accounting. You are actually doing financial reporting. So you could just not, you just cannot fabricate it. The SOFP extracts, you've got intangible assets, significant development, and then total assets and so on and so forth. Now, the requirement to my question was that we had to talk about we had to talk about evaluate and prioritize the significant auditors to be considered in planning the audit of TED company. So when the examiner says significant audit risk, that means he's talking about the major audit risk. So amongst the significant audit risk, I would just try to filter out, I would just try to create some headings. I would just try to make sure that I create some headings and try to discuss those. So one of the thing is that the intangible asset valuation is something that is going to be a key area. The reason being that this is an area which is prone to misstatements. Then I would actually talk about the license income. Then I would talk about the management bias, because you see, as we progress, the information is, this is something that we are actually coming across. Okay. The management bias would also come in here. The accounting for equity portfolio is there. Then what else is going to be there? There are those foreign exchange transactions also. Foreign exchange transactions. That's also there. Then some key ratio analysis. Okay, now let's have a quick discussion on all this. Basically, the examiner has also asked you evaluate and prioritize the significant audit risks to be considered. Now, significance, you might actually have to do filtration, that which are more key areas, which are more risky areas, and things like that. Now, see, are there any other things that you are able to identify? Because I've just classified all of them under these different headings. Yeah, management bias is done. Okay. Now, yeah, derivatives is also done with the accounting for equity portfolio and derivatives. EPS calculations. Okay, let's just try to discuss this. See what has actually happened is, yeah, the materiality calculation, we are just going to talk about them. The reason being, the examiner has already discussed a lot of things. He has already done the analysis. So we are just going to be comparing these things, and we're just going to be doing that. What exactly is the amount, what exactly is it going to be, etc., etc. Now, see, one thing is that he mentioned to us that you could discuss the materiality from the perspective of the profitability, but now this is not appropriate. You need to see that what aspect is this specific area, and then you need to decide. First of all, if I talk about the intangible asset development, 65.7% increase, 58,000, 134,000. Now, you could say the intangible assets are, it's 58,000 divided by 134,000. This would actually mean what? If I say this is actually going to be what? 58,000 divided by 134. 58,000 divided by 134. Now, if I talk about it, what is it actually going to be? 58 divided by 134. It's 43%. Approximately 43.28 or something. 43% of total assets. So when you are going to be writing down the answer like this, you would say the intangible assets are 43% of the total assets of the entity. There has been a significant investment in the game development, which has actually resulted in intangible balance to increase by 65%. Since the development of the intangible is a subjective area, there could be risk of misclassification of the expenses, and there could be misclassification of expenses with respect to the research and development stage. The classification of expenditures under the research would have resulted in them being expensed out and having an adverse impact on the profitability of the business. So there is a risk that the research related costs may have been capitalized. There's actually this risk that the research related costs may have been capitalized. So what happens is there is actually a risk that the research related cost may have been capitalized. And the development expenditure may not meet criteria for the capitalization, resulting in overstatement of the assets. So this is something that you would actually write down with respect to the intangible asset valuation. Why? Because it's a subjective area. It's an area where inappropriate accounting could lead to significant increase in the assets. right? Okay, then we have got license income. With respect to the licenses income, what is actually happening? Now, basically, you need to know that how to actually write down the risk. So first of all, when we are going to go about with this selected finance information, there must be some deferred license income. Is there any? Has he given us the information? Okay, he has not given us any deferred license income, right? Or was it written in the question somewhere? Okay, it's $18 million. So you could simply say that deferred income is 18 million divided by how much is the total assets? 134 million equals to 13.4% of total assets and is therefore material. Now, since licenses are sold over 5 years, licenses are sold with a duration of 5 years. The risks involved are entity may not have any continuing managerial involvement leading to the revenue being recognized in full upon delivery of the license rather than over 5 years. This may lead to understatement of sales and overstatement of liabilities. You see, both the things could happen. Alternatively, if there is a continuing involvement, the recognition of the revenue over the 5 year period may not be an appropriate classification. So you see, this could also be the case that this could not be the appropriate classification. So again, what happens is that from the perspective of the exam, you need to identify that, okay, this is the issue, this is the problem, and this is how it could actually impact, may not be an appropriate classification, resulting in overstatement, or I could say resulting in misstatement of revenue. Resulting in misstatement of revenue. Okay, Sunny, you see what happens is that the profitability cannot be considered, because you see, for the we are not auditing for the investors. I repeat, we are not auditing for the investor, we are an auditor. We are not the investor's agent. You get my point. You're not the investor's agent. You are actually what? You are actually the auditor. So your professional judgment, your skepticism has to be maintained. You get my point? Your skepticism has to be maintained. Right? Okay, so this is what you actually get marks for also. When he says the professional skills. So you actually get marks for this also. Okay, I can explain to you. Yeah, I'm gonna share the answers after the session. Now, yes, I am gonna share, don't worry. Now, Elizabeth, you are asking that, can you explain continuing involvement? Now you see what happens is that maybe we have just given them the license and then we are not gonna give any updates, or we are not gonna continuously monitor their performance, or we are not gonna have any specific thing. So resultingly, what is actually gonna happen is that if we don't have anything to be answerable, we don't have any, like, it's just that you sell the license one time and then rest is the counterparty's thing, that they have to manage it, they have to do things. So that is actually going to mean, I repeat, that is actually going to mean that the risk and rewards have been transferred completely. You don't have to actually worry about it, that what is going to happen. But in case if, like, we have to continuously give updates, we have to continuously look after things, so that would actually mean what? That would actually mean that the continuing involvement is there and the revenue should not be recognized immediately. Okay, when it says that when is materiality based on profit only? So see, what happens is that as an auditor, you got to actually decide that how to assess the materiality for any specific item. Like if there is an asset item, so it has to be determined on the basis of assets. It should not be determined on the basis of profitability. It should be determined on the basis of assets. You get my point? But similarly, if there is this sales, let's say if there is this revenue. So for the revenue, you could actually talk about let's say maybe possible if it's talks about some segment sales or something. So in that case, you could talk about the revenue as a base. Like in this scenario where it says 25% of the revenue is based on the online sales. So if it is 25% on the basis of online sales, what does that mean? 25% on the basis of online sales means the examiner has given on the basis of revenue. So we are going to use that 25%. But in this case, it actually gave us the deferred revenue, deferred income amount. So when it gives you the deferred income amount, so deferred income has to be compared with the balance sheet item, right? Right, thank you. Now, yeah, we would prioritize the risk, Gene. First of all, let's actually answer the question, because you see what happens is that I don't want to end up wasting my time in prioritizing right now. I would be happy to actually write down the answers. And because if I don't prioritize it properly, I will lose 2-3 professional marks. That's it, right? But I won't be losing the whole marks that are there to be captured. So I have not focused upon prioritization right now. I focus more on the actually writing down the risk, on the explanation of the risk, right? Okay. Now let's move a bit forward. The next aspect is that we've got the next thing, which is management bias. You see, now let me just guide you a bit. The company has obtained listing during the current year. The CEO still has 20% shares in the company. The family members of the chief executive officer have 10% shares in the company. So you've got what? The company has obtained listings during the current year. The CEO still has 20% shares in the company. Family members of the CEO have got 10% shares in the company. Now, what is actually going to happen is that the application or the compliance with the Code of Corporate Governance Regulations has not been good, as reflected by not having any internal audit department and with only one executive director being part of the board. So in order to ensure that a better picture of the company is presented, the shareholders to ensure that ensure that listing process went on smoothly and to continuously and to benefit from the subsequent sale of the shares by the family and CEO post listing, there is a risk that the financial statements have been subject to the management bias, resulting in accounting policies having favorable impacts on the profits and assets. You get my point? Because you see, what happens is that there are multiple reasons for you to believe that this is something that would have happened. There are multiple reasons for you to believe that this is something that would have happened. Right? Okay. Then what else is there? Okay. With respect to the foreign exchange transaction, let's talk that how you would actually be answering the foreign exchange transaction. Now, what actually is the risk with respect to foreign exchange transactions? So you have been dealing with, you've been dealing with 60 countries, you've been selling in the 60 countries, and you are surely going to be having transactions in multiple currencies. So what happens is that the accounting is going to be complicated dealing with so many currencies and etc. So we are just going to talk about this, that how it is going to be there. Tiopista, this is similar to massaging the financial statement figures. So it's similar to massaging the financial statement figures. That's what it is going to be. No. Now, when we are actually going to talk about this, so we would say the pointers are going to be, the entity is selling in 60 countries. Transaction risk are faced for these multiple transactions in multiple currencies. Then what actually happens is that the receivables being translated at closing exchange rates would lead to the receivables being translated at the closing exchange rate would lead to receivables being translated at the closing exchange rates would lead to what? Would lead to would lead to exchange gains and losses. Additionally, the hedging relationships have also been created for the foreign currency transactions. All of the above would indicate and suggest that there could be a risk of not accounting for this complex area in an appropriate manner, resulting in misstatement of financial statements. Now, there are a few more things that we could actually discuss over here, but I've just listed down these. I've just explained these things right now. I've not explained each one of them, but I have actually explained these things for the sake of your calculation. And I hope that you people do understand that what are the things that you would have to actually mention from the perspective of the exam. Now, there could be many, many more risks that you could actually write down. But again, I mean, like you see, the examiner's focuses upon the key risk. Now, one thing is that he says that you have to prioritize. Okay, one aspect of the question that we did not consider, and that was basically the e-commerce sales. The e-commerce sales, the electronic sales, the online sales. That's an area that we have not considered. I repeat, that's an area that we have not considered till now. But there could be multiple issues with it. Number one, it's a 25% of the sales. That's one aspect. The second aspect is that I bet there could be multiple aspects. One is that it is 25% of the sales. And the second thing is that it's actually multiple issues, like timing of revenue recognition. That is delivery of the orders, the warranty claims, the deferred income, the contract liabilities. There could be multiple things, but it is actually going to be an area which is very subjective. Do you recognize the sale upon the receipt of order? Do you recognize the sale upon the delivery of item? Do you recognize the sale upon the time at which the revenue is being credited into your account? What exactly is the time at which you actually go about doing this? So you see, there is actually going to be something that you would have to consider, that you would have to be concerned about. Because the thing is that ultimately, this is an area which is important. You get my point? So what have I done? I've actually discussed this specific area also. Now what I would actually want to do is that I want to discuss with you people that how could we prioritize the risk? I would like to discuss with you people that how could we prioritize the risk? Can any one of you suggest that which risk should be there, which should be there, the prioritization of the risk? Can anyone just do it? No, it's a scenario based, but again, in this specific scenario, can you just identify which are the risks to be considered, which are the risks to be ignored? Okay, see, when we talk about the prioritization of the risk, so ultimately, which would have the most impact on the financial statement, which would most impact the shareholders' decision making, that is what you have to do. So, yes, can you just suggest? Yeah, can you people just share the list, please? Okay, revenue recognition, Sunny Kumar, derivative, EPS, equity, okay. Value less than intangible, e-commerce derivatives, okay. Okay. To me, this e-commerce is an issue. To me, this e-commerce is an issue. To me, this intangible is an issue. Why? Because intangible is basically a significant portion of the company's assets, and it could impact your profitability a lot also. So I would rather focus more on the profitability and the sales and all that. I'll tell you why. The reason being that the company has actually got itself listed. And when the company has itself got listed during the year, so ultimately what happens is that the more areas that are to be focused are the ones that are pertaining to the accounting policy recognition, the financial statements and all that. So I would even put this EPS above the accounting entry or accounting for equity transactions. So my classification would be I would go for intangible assets, but let me just see that how much is intangible as a proportion of the sales or something. 58,000, 58 million. It's 98,000, but how much is the increase? It's like 10 to significant. Okay. We could just go about this intangible e-commerce license, management bias, foreign exchange transaction, things like that. We could just go about it. Okay, why is EPS an audit risk? See, what happens is that you are a listed company. Being a listed company, you need to make sure that being a listed company, you have a requirement that so I would just list down. It's a listed company. It's an important disclosure. On the face of financial statement, it's an important disclosure on the face of financial statement. Share issue has taken place during the year. The calculation of weighted average shares might have been an issue. So you see what happens is that these are the multiple factors that would ultimately lead to the EPS calculation being impacted. So that's why it's actually an audit risk. And it's a key disclosure. I repeat, it's a key disclosure. You just cannot ignore this disclosure. Yeah, is that okay? Okay, now what else is going to be there? Let's move a bit forward. Okay, now we move a bit forward. Okay, you want me to actually, okay, EPS calculation. See, what happens is that when you calculate the economic, this earning per share, you have to calculate the profit attributable to ordinary shareholders of the parent entity divided by weighted average number of ordinary shares outstanding during the year. Now, basically what happens over here is that when it says profit attributable to ordinary shareholders of the parent entity, so that means whatever the profit for the ordinary shareholders, you have to calculate that. Then similarly, you have to go for the weighted average number of shares. So resultingly, what could happen is that, let me just guide you something. Basically, what happens is that there is a detailed calculation for the number of shares. There is a detailed calculation for the profit, which you have to do. And there is a likelihood that there is going to be an error with respect to all this. Now let's talk about the further requirement of this question, that what exactly are the further requirement of the question. Now, there is basically a requirement which says, explain our responsibilities. Our responsibilities in relation to the corresponding figures and how they should be discharged. So basically what happens is that here you have to write down the auditor's responsibility with respect to the corresponding figure. So if I could just guide you that what exactly is going to happen with respect to the corresponding figures and all that. So there are a few things that you actually need to understand, that what exactly are the corresponding figures, what exactly are these things. So basically what happens is that, let me guide you, that whenever the concept of corresponding figures is the comparative information related to the amounts and the other disclosures which are an integral part of the current period financial statements. So they are actually considered to be the corresponding figures. So I repeat, what exactly is the corresponding figures? So whenever you have got the comparative information related to the previous year, so they are actually going to be considered as the corresponding figure. And what actually happens is that the auditor is not required to give an opinion on the corresponding figures. I repeat, the auditor is not required to give the opinion with respect to the corresponding figure. Unless there are a few things. Number one, which is basically, if the modification took place in the prior year and the modification is still unresolved, then, so basically what happens is that if the modification took place in the prior year and the modification is still unresolved, then what you actually need to do is that, what you could do with respect to it is that then the audit opinion for the current year can also be modified on the basis of unresolved issues related to the corresponding figures. So if there is basically a corresponding issue, corresponding item, where there was this, there was modification and that matter is still not resolved, the current year audit opinion is also going to be modified on the basis of that specific thing. Furthermore, if I talk a bit further, I need to discuss few more things. That what are the other things that the auditor has to do? The written representations from the management are required to be obtained in relation to the corresponding figures. The written representations from the management are required to be obtained in relation to the corresponding figures. Right, so basically what is the, just a minute, okay, so basically when we are talking about this corresponding figures, the concept of corresponding figures is going to be that those figures which are basically being which are pertaining to the prior period but are being presented here also, they're considered to be the corresponding figures. So auditor has a responsibility that he/she has to look after the corresponding figures and see if there are any unresolved matters with respect to the corresponding figures in the previous period financial statement. So what the auditor would have to do is that auditor would have to consider them. Plus, what else the auditor has to do? The auditor also has to actually obtain the written representations with respect to the corresponding figures from the management. And those written representations are actually going to be focused upon what? Those written representations are going to be just to ensure that the management has basically taken care of the issues that were there with respect to the corresponding figures. Now, last is that it says design the audit procedure to be performed in the audit of portfolio of short-term investment and with respect to the earning per share. Now, always remember that what actually happens is that when we are talking about the audit procedure, I'll just give you a bit of an idea that the audit procedures are what? The audit procedure is AEIOU. That's what the audit procedure is, which is analytical procedure, the external confirmation, the inquiry, the inspection, the observation, and recalculations. Now, how exactly do we perform the audit procedures? So there is always going to be, for each procedure, there has to be what? There has to be an objective. For each procedure, there has to be an objective, there has to be an action, and there has to be a source document. Like, for example, when we talk about the portfolio of short-term investments, what is it that we are trying to achieve with respect to it? We would actually recalculate the fair value. Okay, first of all, because I need to inspect the cost, so I inspect the purchase documents of the equity investment to confirm the cost. Obtain the fair value available for the investment and reconfirm from the available data about its accuracy. Recalculate the gain slash loss on the remeasurement of the equity investments and confirm that the same is correctly recognized in the income statement. Inspect notes to the accounts to confirm that appropriate disclosure notes are provided. So you have to inspect the notes to the account to confirm that the appropriate disclosure notes are provided. With respect to the earning per share calculation, with respect to the earning per share figure, so you see what happens is that you have to perform the procedures on what? On the profit calculation, on the number of shares issued, the weighted average number of shares calculation, the inspection of notes and the financial statements for the correct presentation of the EPS figure. So what is actually going to happen is that this is something that you are going to do. I repeat, this is something that you are going to do. So do you people get it? Okay, good enough. So basically, we have actually gone through this specific question. Okay, good enough. So we have actually gone through this specific question and we have discussed this. What I'm going to do is that I'm going to save the answer to the question so that I could share with you people. And I hope that the session was valuable and beneficial for you all. And if there are any questions further that you would like to ask, just ask, and I'll be happy to answer them. Okay, good enough. So thank you very much, all of you, for being there. Thank you for attending. And a bit of apologies if there was some background noise of the kids. Unfortunately, you just cannot stop them to stay away from you for a lot of time. So ultimately, they actually do create some background noises. Okay, you could just message our team. Let's meet up Suni Kumar tomorrow also, the next session. So inshallah, taking it through further for the next session, inshallah. Yes, Muhammad Hassan, just wait for tomorrow. We'll be doing a question this. Okay, thanks a lot, everyone. Thank you.